Hello, welcome to my first lecture in place, focusing on the music of Antonio Vivaldi. I'm joined here by Sylvester, and if our production values seem a bit homemade, that's because we are stuck at home. But the hope is to just share some information and hopefully something enlightening about this great composer. Antonio Vivaldi was a giant of the Baroque age, composing a wide variety of genres and over 500 concertos for many combinations of instruments. He possessed gifts of extraordinary imagination and invention, yet much of his best music is not widely known. I always like to start by getting into the sound world of a composer that I'm discussing. So here is the first movement from Vivaldi's Concerto in D Major, RV 230, number 9 from L'Espro Armonico, as transcribed for the keyboard by Johann Sebastian Bach. Experiences anything like most people, when it comes to the name Vivaldi, you might think, ah yes, Vivaldi, the Four Seasons, the Gloria. I know his music. We've shared an elevator together many times. While the general public, I think, has a somewhat limited knowledge of Vivaldi's output beyond these famous pieces. I have performed many works by Vivaldi, and yet I will confess that in delving more deeply into his life, I found that I really didn't know much about him at all. So my hope is to broaden your appreciation of the music of Vivaldi and introduce you to some pieces that I particularly love. I think one of the reasons that we tend to sort of be satisfied with knowing just a few works by a given composer is that there is so much music to know, and it's kind of easy when we just stop without exploring more, but it's really wonderful when we get more deeply into their output. You could say that the birth of Antonio Lucio Vivaldi was earth-shaking. The day he was born, March 4, 1678, a large earthquake occurred in Venice. It was also discovered that Vivaldi received two baptisms. He was so weak at birth that the midwife who assisted in his birth baptized him on the spot. But he survived and was formally baptized by the parish priest 1 month later. Vivaldi received instruction on the violin from his father, Giovanni Battista Vivaldi. The fact that his father was a barber surgeon is something that he shares in common with George Frideric Handel. Giovanni, his father, was accepted into the orchestra at the Basilica of San Marco, a place where I'm sure many of you have visited. His son Antonio became an exceedingly fine violinist and made his first appearance that we know of in 1698 at the age of 20, playing as an extra in the orchestra at San Marco. Antonio began studies for the priesthood at the age of 15 and was ordained in 1703 at the age of 25. Due to his red hair, posterity gave him the name Il Prete Rosso, or the Red Priest. But within a year of his ordination, Vivaldi chose to stop saying Mass. Later in life, he wrote to an acquaintance that an asthmatic condition kept him from completing the Mass several times, and therefore he chose to stop doing it. It has been noted that for a man who maintains such a vigorous career, this citation of physical weakness is a paradox. In any case, Vivaldi's withdrawal from traditional priestly duties resulted in him having more time to compose and for music. In the same year he was ordained, 1703, Vivaldi landed a position at the place where he would spend much of his career, L'Ospedale della Pietà in Venice. L'Ospedale della Pietà was an orphanage where boys learned a trade and girls who showed aptitude for music received training in instruments and singing. Under Vivaldi's guidance, the girls of L'Ospedale della Pietà became renowned as one of the finest ensembles in Europe, and they played a very important role in soliciting gifts and legacies to support the orphanage. A visitor, Charles de Brosse, who was the president of the Burgundian Parliament, wrote of hearing Vivaldi's pupils and said, "They are trained only to excel at music. They sing like angels. They play the violin, the flute, the organ, the oboe. In short, there is no instrument so large that they are afraid of it." Well, Vivaldi held several positions at L'Ospedale della Pietà. He served as master of violin and director of instrumental music, and paid composer. You'll see that he had a couple of stints at each of these compensated positions. They weren't full-time positions, but it was probably the most sustaining association he had in his life. Vivaldi first published compositions in 1705, a set of trio sonatas and a set of violin sonatas then in 1709. You'll notice that just like we have K numbers with Mozart's music and BWV numbers for Bach's music, we have RV numbers for Vivaldi, and the RV stands for Riom Verzeichnis, after the Danish musicologist Peter Riom, who created Vivaldi's catalog. One can say with firm authority that Vivaldi's place in music history was secured by becoming the first and most prolific composer of concertos, one of the most important genres of the 18th century. In 1711, the set of compositions on which much of Vivaldi's fame was spread was published by the firm of Etienne Roger in Amsterdam. It was entitled L'Estro Armonico, The Harmonic Inspiration, a collection of 12 concertos for different string soloists with string orchestra. Let's listen to one of the famous ones from this group, the Opus 3, number 11 in D minor. And you can listen for the following. In the opening section, we hear the vigorous interplay of the solo violins. This is followed by a typically brief, slow interlude of almost skeletal repeated chords that serve as a background for the improvisation of the soloist. Then begins a fugal texture, which begins in the basses, and each of the different sections of the orchestra enter one by one.
Thank you.
The publication of L'Estro Armonico spread Vivaldi's fame far and wide. It was most likely through this publication that Johann Sebastian Bach obtained a copy of Vivaldi's music, and one clear indication of Vivaldi's importance was the high esteem in which he was regarded by J.S. Bach. Bach transcribed numerous concertos by Vivaldi and completely absorbed the Italian style, as we see in works by him such as the Italian Concerto, the Cantata No. 209, Non so che sia dolore, and countless instrumental pieces. So, you heard the piece that I played at the opening of this lecture, and this is one of a number of concertos that Bach transcribed for keyboard, such as the D minor concerto you listened to a moment ago as well, which he transcribed for organ. I'd like you to listen now to the concerto for two violins and cello in A minor. So I recorded the first movement of Bach's transcription of this very concerto, so you can hear how the same music sounds on the organ. In 1725, Vivaldi published another collection of concertos. This was entitled Il Cimento dell'Armonia e dell'Invenzione, the contest between harmony and invention. This is the set that includes Il Quattro Stagioni, or the Four Seasons, or as my friend Nicholas Kramer likes to call them, Il Quattro Formaggio. Here's an image of Vivaldi from the same year of 1725 that this music was published. These 12 concertos as a whole represent Vivaldi's highest achievement in the concerto genre. Here are a list of the contents, and you'll see that the first four concertos are the ones we know as the Four Seasons. But the other concertos in this set are also magnificent, and several are also programmatic like the Four Seasons. We have La Tempesta di Mare and La Caccia, known as The Hunt. La Tempesta di Mare is a particularly wonderful concerto. So before jumping into a discussion about the Four Seasons, I'd love for you to listen to a bit of this terrific piece. One thing to note about it is the key, which is E flat major. And that's significant because we should just consider for a moment how the violin is constructed. You'll see that it has the four strings. These are what we call open strings tuned in fifths. Let's just take a quick look at the open fifths, the strings of the violin. We have G, D, A, and E. And it's no coincidence that the majority of violin concertos, or at least many of them, are in keys that correspond to those open strings. Think of the Beethoven concerto in D major, and we think of, for instance, the Mendelssohn violin concerto in E minor, E major. So those are two examples. But not this concerto, Tempesta di Mare, that's in E flat major. So it's not really using many of those open strings as much at all. But take a listen to this really compelling music. So as you heard, that music is blustery and stormy and very appropriate for depicting the drenching rain and a tempest at sea. So on to the Four Seasons. Two aspects are particularly notable that I would want to mention. The high level of invention in this music and Vivaldi's expert understanding of the acoustical properties of string instruments. Take, for example, the wonderful evocation of birdsong we hear early in the first movement of the Spring Concerto, which happens to be in E major. The key is important, really, because it allows the three violin soloists the most resonance possible. Here is a wonderful soloist from the Netherlands, Janine Jansen, playing with the International Kammermusik Festival. Another facet I would want to note is the raw power and energy that's generated just by unison strings playing together. And Vivaldi understood and exploits this to terrific effect in the Four Seasons. One example would be from the Summer Concerto. you hear the incredible kinetic energy that's generated from these string players playing in unison together. Another example of that we can hear in the last movement of the Winter Concerto. Vivaldi's use of texture is another facet that's quite important in The Four Seasons, and I would describe it as a sort of stratification of musical material. Take, for instance, the slow movement in the Spring Concerto. You'll see here that the two interior lines of Violin 1 and Violin 2 represent the murmur of plants and fronds in the breeze. The top line is the sleeping goat herd. And the bottom line you see there is his faithful dog at his side, played by the violas. The dog is barking. I have personally always wondered how that goat herd gets any sleep with the dog constantly barking. Another good example of Vivaldi's stratification would be in the Winter Concerto. And it's important to understand that these concertos had sonnets and sentences that accompanied them to explain what was supposed to be happening, the programmatic elements, if you were. And the description Vivaldi describes that's written above the score for this slow movement, the Largo in the Winter Concerto, is: "Before the fire, to pass peaceful, contented days while the rain outside pours down." And he creates a sense of constancy with the viola line that's just sustained, and underneath that, a gentle pulsation of eighth notes in the bass line. The rain is depicted by the violins, which are more active. And then the beautiful melodic line of the soloist above that. We can almost picture whoever's being shown there reading a book in a cozy house by a warm fire while it's very chilly and rainy outside. On a personal note, I first recorded the Four Seasons of Vivaldi many years ago playing harpsichord with an orchestra. And on this recording, the narrations of these sonnets were done by Patrick Stewart. And I thought you might enjoy hearing just a little bit of Patrick Stewart narrating Vivaldi.
To walk on the ice with slow steps, in fear of falling, advance with care. Then to step forth strongly, fall to the ground, and again run boldly on the ice until it cracks and breaks. To listen as from the iron portals rush winds from south and north, all the winds in contest. Such is winter, such the joy it brings.
Don't you think they sound rather good with Captain Picard doing the narrating? Well, back in time a little bit, between 1711 and 1719, that same firm in Amsterdam published four more sets of Vivaldi's instrumental works. The year 1713 saw two new avenues of composition open up to Vivaldi: sacred music and opera. In this year, the choir master at L'Ospedale della Pietà stepped down from his position, and they turned to Vivaldi to start providing sacred music. Meanwhile, Vivaldi's first opera, Orlando in Villa, was premiered in Vicenza. Since the mid-1630s, Venice had been a hotbed for opera, and soon Vivaldi was pulled into acting as both a composer and impresario there. More about opera later. In 1718, Vivaldi left Venice for Mantua, Monteverdi's old stomping grounds, to become the director of secular music for the city's governor, Prince Philip of Hesse-Darmstadt. This was the only full-time post that Vivaldi ever held, and after 2 years, he seemed eager to return to the freelance life and the flexibility that it afforded. The 1720s were really the apex of Vivaldi's career. While based in Venice, he traveled widely to destinations such as Rome, Amsterdam, Prague, and ultimately Vienna. When one considers that any trip north involved going over the Alps, well, it took a lot of fortitude to do this. And again, we consider his own account of his physical weakness, but he did it a number of times. He began to enjoy commissions from numerous patrons around Europe. Between 1725 and 1729, he published 5 more sets of concertos. After 1729, Vivaldi stopped having his music published as he found he could do better selling individual copies to private subscribers. A piece that I really hold in high esteem is another work that Vivaldi wrote for a commission, this time for the orchestra in Dresden. This is his Concerto per l'Orchestra di Dresda, RV 577. It was commissioned sometime between 1720 and 1724. I think it's some of Vivaldi's finest concerto writing. Just take a look at the first page of score, and you'll see everything that's about to happen with a pair of flutes, a pair of oboes, bassoon solo percolating from underneath. It's just marvelous music. I'd love for you to listen to just the opening of this concerto. Another concerto I love is only about 4 minutes long in total, and it's called the Concerto alla Rustica. And I'll just play a tiny bit of the opening so you can get the feel for it. It's really like an Italian hoedown, isn't it? In the 1720s, Vivaldi's operatic ambitions continued. Starting in 1726, a certain contralto named Anna Giraud began to appear regularly in his operas. She was reported to have a somewhat weak voice, but was quite attractive and acted well. Rumors circulated that she was more than just a contralto to Vivaldi. Scandalous. Well, he received commissions for sacred music as well from many quarters, and one such came in 1725 for the marriage of Louis XV. His setting for this was of the Gloria in Excelsis, and it has, of course, become one of his most beloved pieces. What I'd like to have you see now is just an excerpt from a terrific reconstruction of a performance of this work, as it might have occurred at L'Ospedale della Pietà. And you'll see, just as was the case, all of these female musicians are behind screens where they weren't observed directly as they made the music. And this is a reconstruction that you can see on YouTube by the BBC. And in my opinion, nobody does musical reconstructions as well as the BBC. Now, I would love to discuss a work that I consider to be one of Vivaldi's greatest that you might not know. It's the Dixit Dominus RV 809. And this has a very interesting story. Sometimes in the history of music, pieces are discovered just hidden away, like an aria by Bach that was found in a shoebox not so long ago, or the Gloria as set by George Frideric Handel from his early Italian days that had been sitting in the British Royal Library all along and just needed to be identified as being by Handel. Well, this is a slightly different situation. An Australian musicologist named Janice Stoptic undertook a re-examination of various musical holdings in the Saxon State Library in Dresden back in 2005. And the Dixit Dominus in question had made its way there as a group of pieces that the Elector of Saxony had acquired in the 1750s as part of a large group of Venetian music ordered from the music copying firm of one Iseppo Baldan. Now, Baldan's reputation among modern musicologists is tainted because he had a penchant for giving false attributions of composers to music to make it more salient or interesting. While the majority of the vocal works sent by Baldan to Dresden were those of Baldassare Galuppi, this Dixit Dominus was wrongly listed as the work of Galuppi. Baldan's motivation for such a forgery is suspected to be that by the 1750s, Galuppi was an active and popular composer, whereas Vivaldi had been dead since 1741. Professor Stockdick's astute supposition that this Dixit Dominus was actually the work of Vivaldi was confirmed by a leading Vivaldi scholar, Michael Talbot. Together, the two musicologists published their findings in 2006, citing elements of notation, score layout, structure, and thematic borrowings that conclusively established the hand of Vivaldi. The Istituto Italiano Antonio Vivaldi and the Italian publisher Ricordi quickly issued the work as part of their series of critical Vivaldi editions. The following year, in 2007, it was my privilege to give one of the first performances in North America at Northwestern University of this wonderful piece. I'm going to play several excerpts of this work for you so you can get to know it a little bit. And some of the outstanding features of this Dixit Dominus RV 809 include some terrific choruses, including the very opening of the piece. So let's listen to that. Another movement that I adore is a duet for two tenors to the text Tecum Principium, which translates in the fullness of the text to "In the day of thy power shall the people offer thee freewill offerings." And you'll hear a very bouncy violin and string introduction, and then the two tenors come in and imitate each other very exactly. I think it's okay, even though it's a sacred piece, to say this movement is kind of fun. Tecum principium, in Bienen lovely point in this Dixit Dominus setting comes with the text De torrente in via bibet, he shall drink of the brook in the way. And you'll hear the evocation of the brook with the flowing music that introduces this text. I'd like you to hear the end of this work because it's such a terrific showpiece for the chorus. One thing that's interesting is he brings back music like the beginning, just before the final section, exactly as he does in the Gloria, where we hear the opening music of the Gloria just very in a truncated form before the final fugal ending. And he does pretty much exactly the same thing here with the text Sicut erat in principio, followed by the Et in seculo seculorum, Amen. And it's a wonderful fugal writing for the chorus. So this is about 3 minutes long, but I think you will, after listening to it, hopefully agree with me that this is some really terrific music.
Et in seculo seculorum, et in seculo seculorum.
here's another significant piece by Vivaldi that I was not familiar with before, but now I really want to perform, having looked into it a bit. This is Vivaldi's Judite Triumphans Devicta Holer Finis Barbarie. So, Judith's triumph over the barbarian Holofernes. It was composed sometime around 1716 to celebrate the victory of Venice over the Turks at Corfu. Now, all the characters in this oratorio, male and female, were portrayed by the girls, the musicians at L'Ospedale della Pietà. Given that it references a military victory, the use of trumpets and drums is not at all surprising, as we hear in the opening chorus, which is a call to arms. There are so many interesting elements with the orchestration of this work. For example, in Judita's aria, Veni, Veni, Me, Sequera, Fida, the solo soprano, Shalomo, a predecessor of the clarinet, portrays the sound of the wood dove in one of the instrument's earliest uses with orchestra. And I want to just play the opening of this aria more than the singing of it so you can hear and see the soprano Shalomo. Another aria for Judita, Somme Estrorum Creator, that is accompanied rather unusually by four solo viola da gambas. Listen to this sonority. Thank you. sure you'll agree that the solemn sound of those viola da gambas is perfect for the seriousness of that aria. There's so much wonderful invention like this that we see in Vivaldi. So doesn't it make you wonder a bit about all those operas he wrote? Have you ever attended a production of an opera by Vivaldi? Well, he was heavily involved in organizing, composing, and conducting opera for much of his career. Venetians loved their opera, which in Italy has always been something of a contact sport for the audiences. Many of Vivaldi's operas were performed at the Teatro Sant'Angelo in Venice. The Englishman Edward Wright, in his book, Some Observations Made Traveling Throughout France and Italy, wrote about the experience of going to opera in Venice. He said, "They have a scandalous custom there of spitting from the upper boxes, as well as throwing pairings of apples and oranges, etc., upon the company in the pit, which they do at random, without any regard to where it falls." So it gives you some idea what it must have been like to try to listen to an opera there. You know, I was contemplating these composers such as Vivaldi and Haydn, who spent so much of their career composing opera, and it made me wonder if they agreed to librettos that were not so compelling because they knew the audience would not be as attentive as audiences are today. It's hard to say. Vivaldi was engaged to be the impresario for the Venetian carnival seasons of 1714 and 15, during which his highly successful Orlando Furioso was premiered. Getting operas performed in the 18th century often involved a dance around censors. For instance, Vivaldi's opera Arsilda Regina di Ponto was initially banned because it had a controversial plot. The main character, Arsilda, falls in love with a woman who turns out to actually be a man. Well, of course, that's opera for you. After some schmoozing of the censors, Vivaldi was able to get that opera performed the next season. Opera was an enormous part of his life as a composer. He wrote 50 operas, and they contain certainly marvelous music, but widely unknown. Of course, any composer of opera in Italy, then as in now, was a target for harsh criticism. Vivaldi's nemesis was none other than the composer Benedetto Marcello, who in 1720 anonymously published a pamphlet entitled Il Teatro alla Moda. He lambasted Vivaldi for everything from far-fetched plots to extravagant scenery to formulaic music. He even chastised Vivaldi's dedications, saying that Vivaldi would write things like, "He hereby kissed with great respect the fleas on the paws of your excellency's dog." Well, I think we should hear a bit of Vivaldi's operatic music. How about a touch from Orlando Furioso, which has received some modern productions? Let's listen to Cecilia Bartoli singing Ah, Fuggi Rapido, or Ah, Flee Quickly. Fantastic, isn't it? I mean, at a minimum, it makes for great concert programming. One of the few images we have of Vivaldi from his lifetime, we happen to owe to his involvement in opera, because it was done in Rome. It's a caricature, and he was in Rome in 1723 to do his opera Capranica. And here's the caricature that was made by Pier Leone Ghezzi. Vivaldi was an extremely prolific composer. Charles de Brosse, president again of the Parliament of Burgundy, described this encounter with Vivaldi when the latter was near the end of his life. "He's an old man, composes furiously, composing vast amounts of music. He claimed to be able to compose a concerto with all its parts faster than a copyist could write it down." And just take a look here at the extent of Vivaldi's composition, with 500 concertos and 50 operas and sonatas and so many pieces that deserve a further look, for sure. Despite his many publications, Vivaldi was headed toward becoming a footnote in music history until, in 1926, many of his manuscripts were rediscovered at a religious college in Piedmont. Thanks to one Dr. Alberto Gentile, the manuscripts were obtained for posterity by being purchased from a private holder. Somewhat as happened with Bach in the 19th century, Vivaldi's Renaissance occurred in the 20th century, and there are still pieces out there to be found or correctly attributed to Vivaldi. Vivaldi became known to European nobility, though his career began to decline in the 1740s as musical fashions changed. He was knighted by Charles VI and ultimately moved to Vienna, but Charles died soon after and Vivaldi was left without a supporter. Unfortunately, Vivaldi died penniless in Vienna. Now here's a fascinating consideration. Had Vivaldi been more of means at that point, at the time of his death, when he had his funeral at St. Stephen's in Vienna in 1741, then he could have afforded a choir, and one of the singers, one of the choristers in the choir at that time, was none other than Joseph Haydn. As it was, Vivaldi was penniless, and so only the church bells were rung. Like Mozart, Vivaldi was buried in an unmarked grave. Mozart may have ultimately been buried close to him some 50 years later, but we'll never know, as the Vienna University for Technology, which exists now, was built over the site. So, to conclude, I want to just thank you for being a part of this first lecture in place on the music of Antonio Vivaldi. Sylvester and I have appreciated your company, and I hope you've enjoyed a chance to hopefully learn a bit more about this fabulous composer. Thanks very much. Oh,